So it feels like a continuation from last week as we looked around the room to pray for one another and made eye contact with others. And just on a side note, there's many of you, there was more than normal in a normal sermon for me, many of you responded that that was of great encouragement, that someone locked eyes with you and you prayed for them and then you got to tell them that you were praying for them. So, and I did have one person say they weren't prayed for. I'm not going to throw them out right now so that you all know, because then you'd all pray for them and they'd really feel bad. But make sure that you do continue to keep praying for one another. This is why we're here. This isn't just an opportunity to sing a few songs and to hear a nice message. This is also an opportunity for us as ministers, co-ministers, to minister to one another and to listen to the needs as we heard, whether it be sickness or encouragement or names of people that are on our hearts and minds. Whatever the need may be, this is why we gather, so that we can encourage one another. So I would like to hit pause on the sharing time, but now pause and pray and talk to the Lord as we open His Word together. Would you bow your heads with me, please? Jesus, You are sovereign and You are good. And even though we don't understand all the intricacies that You are in charge of, today we worship You. We are grateful that You call us sons and daughters, that You love us enough to give Your life for us. We rest in the fact that You are in charge and we are not. We are grateful that You don't give us more than we can handle, even though sometimes it feels like it's too much. Allow us to trust You more and more. Give us peace that surpasses all understanding here this morning. And as we worship You with words and listening to the words of Paul, that we believe are inspired words to encourage us, give us good correction, good encouragement, and a good challenge here today. It's in Your name we pray, Jesus. Amen. I forgot to mention last week that I use the New Living Translation, so if you're on an app or you want to get one, you can do that. That's typically what I use, but sometimes people say, well, what else do you use? Well, I'm just giving you a little snippet of what I do. I like to use the New American Standard Bible. That's what I grew up with. I also like the English Standard Version. That one's a little bit clunkier as far as English-wise, but it's really accurate to the Greek and Hebrew, so those just give you a little snapshot. And then I like the NIV, pretty similar to the New Living Translation as far as teaching from. But on a general rule, New Living Translation. Just wanted to put that out there in case any of you are like, what is he using? So as we go through today, I was reading, there's like a preacher's outline and study Bible from that talks about Ephesians, and I use that to gather some of my notes. I don't want you to think all this stuff is just up here. I have to study just as hard as some of you, and probably harder sometimes to get it to work in my brain. But as I was reading this, I just want a direct quote from the preacher's outline and study Bible here this morning, because it deals with the passage that we're going to be in. If you want to turn there already, we're going to be in Ephesians 1. We're going to cover verses 19 through 23. And I wanted to read this quote. It says, "This passage today covers the power of God. If mankind ever needed anything, it is certainly the power of God in their lives. If mankind has ever been gripped by evil and shame, bitterness and hate, lust and immorality, cursing and anger, robbery and assault, murder and war, selfishness and greed, division and strife, disappointment and emptiness, boredom and purposelessness, it is today. Mankind desperately needs the power of God to help them in their daily lives and to right the wrongs of society." The power of God is what we're going to talk about. And that's a pretty massive subject, and there certainly isn't enough time or pages or words to describe and truly narrow God into a little box and define Him completely. And as we worship him, there's going to be opportunities that I'm going to ask for you guys to shout out in a bit, some words that come to your mind when you worship God, names of God. So you can be thinking about those. But in our society, as we kind of set the stage for this passage that we're going to be looking at, we all know that there is authority and power that we have to deal with. Whether you respect authority or not, there are authorities that are out there, and they surround us. There's rules everywhere you go. Sometimes we just ignore rules, but they're there, just like speed limit signs. I don't even know why they put them on like on I-70, but they're there. There are rules that we're supposed to follow, but some people think that there aren't lanes. Some people think that they don't have to use blinkers, all that stuff. Maybe their blinker fluid's out. I don't know. But we are expected to submit to authority. And some people have a hard time with that. Usually it's dealing with their childhood and how they were punished or how authorities dealt with them, or maybe they just had an argumentative spirit about them and they never really got along well with authority. Well, we know that there's a different way in the Bible. We follow Jesus, who led by example and with a true type of authority and leadership that had never been seen before. He commanded respect and authority, and they would even look at him and say, but he's not even trained. How does he know this stuff? I mean, the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the religious leaders of the day, when they saw Jesus, they had to scratch their head and just say, how is he smarter than us? How does he know this stuff? And even when he was 12 years old, he knew more than some of them. And he asked good questions, and I love that about Jesus. Because his authority, if I had to define it in a couple of different ways, but his authority was so unique. Because oftentimes in this world, don't we want answers? When we go to somebody, we just want to know, could you just tell me the answer to this question that I have? Jesus flipped it on its head so often. If you look at Jesus, he would ask them a question back. Now, it's a great leadership style, and he wasn't dodging the issue. He knew the answer. But so often, Jesus asked a question back. But when we look around, we see leadership, typically in this society, it means that you have success financially, or you have a strong military, or you are in a position of power and rank, and you have people all around you that can back it up with bigger guns. And you look around the world, there are even countries that are described as superpowers. Why? Usually it means they have big bombs and they have a lot of people. Those are the two things that they have. That's what a superpower is. But superpower, does that mean that they are nice? Does that mean that they are kind and encouraging? Does that mean they lead by example and their leader leads the charge on the battlefield? No. Usually means it's a dictatorship, or someone's just has a lot of power, or they took it by force. They stole that authority by taking down their predecessor. Well, aren't we glad that we worship Jesus, who has a completely different leadership style? Aren't we glad that when we look to the world and all the chaos and people just making threats and negotiations and it's we'll give you more money and we won't bomb you and all these different things that are happening all around the world. Anytime you turn on the news, it seems like that's what it says. But Jesus led beautifully. And I want us to look at this. Before we get to the passage, I want to talk about the three things that we're going to discuss today. Jesus has more power and authority than we can fathom. His love is everlasting. And as followers of Christ, that same love and authority is available to us. Now, those are going to come up again. If you can't write it down fast enough or you can't take a picture fast enough, that's okay. We're going to switch to the scripture passage, though, right now. And we're going to look at Ephesians chapter 1, verses 19 through 23. And you can follow along on the screen, or if you want to read in your own, they're probably pretty close. I also pray that you will understand the incredible greatness of God's power for us who believe. Just want to make sure they were the same. This is the same mighty power that raised Christ from the dead and seated him in the place of honor at God's right hand in the heavenly realms. Now he is far above any ruler or authority or power or leader or anything else, not only in this world, but also in the world to come. Isn't that a thought? God has put all things under the authority of Christ and has made him head over all things for the benefit of the church. And the church is his body. It is made full and complete by Christ, who fills all things everywhere with himself. These are the words of Paul to the church of Ephesus. These are the words to encourage us. These are the words to help us understand in a new, with a new set of eyes, the authority and the power that we cannot even begin to understand or fathom that Jesus has. And that is beautiful. It's not that we need more books about Jesus to be able to understand him better. He is so magnificent that there's not a book that could describe him completely. And I want us to get lost in the wonderment of who God is. But before we get there, I want us to go back a little bit in Ephesians. You see, we are called to unity. We are called to gather together. We are called to love on one another. We're processing how powerful as it was last week to pray for one another, to look around at our fellow man and woman and say, God loves you and so do I. How can I love on you more? How can I know you more? And that is uniquely beautiful. And today, as you've heard me say, but I want to repeat it in a different way, we're taking a step towards the magnificence of God's power and authority. God's power and authority and the magnificence of it. It is so beautiful. So let's begin. Let's break down these verses, if we could today, and take some time to reflect and to see how beautiful God is. So the first statement that we're going to deal with that I wrote is Jesus has more power and authority than we can fathom. As you look at verse 19, we see that there's incredible greatness of God's power for those who believe, the same mighty power that raised Christ from the dead. You can begin to see that how powerful God is. This power is defined if you look at some comparable usages throughout scriptures. This could be defined as incomparable power, surpassing power, unlimited power, immeasurable power, beyond imagination power. How fascinating is that? That God's power is so much bigger than we could ever comprehend, that the moment you try to define his power, he's greater than that. That just makes my little squirrel brain hurt, because I can't fathom something far greater than I can fathom. I mean, isn't that just a crazy thought? I mean, as a kid, when somebody would talk to me about eternity, that's a really funny thought as a kid, because time's so slow when you're a kid. You feel like it's forever until you grow up, and everything takes forever, and you're always hungry, and mom's taking forever to make the meal. Like, everything just so much slower, and you just want everything to be right on top of you. Well, I remember going to church one time and the pastor was talking about eternity, and I just thought, what? And so in my little squirrel brain, I don't know why I said that, but I'm going to stick with it. My little brain, I think about eternity as a kid, and I remember just being so bombarded with impossible thoughts. And I just, see, I thought church was what heaven was going to be like. And I grew up in a really quiet church, and it was kind of boring, and I didn't really like it. So I thought, eternity of that? I just imagined somebody up there, today we're going to sing a song, and it's going to be on repeat all morning long. Like, I could sing of your love forever and ever and ever and ever. I was like, stop. Is this all that it is? I couldn't fathom that. Just sounded painful to me. And then I started thinking, well, I could imagine like 1,000 years, I guess. But 1,000 years is like a day. Oh, no. Like, what does that mean? But as we start to comprehend, and we're not talking about heaven, we're not talking about eternity today, but I just want you to grasp how powerful and wonderful and amazing God is. It is, eternity is good, and it is wonderful, and you will lose track of time. Time won't even make sense, because you will be so caught up in worship. And you will actually have jobs that are good that you want to go to. We'll have things to do in the new heaven and the new earth. We'll be astounded at God's glory every day. Every day will be wonderful. And it's not just a song that you are not sure about singing forever. It will be beautiful, and your heart cry will be just as Connie was sharing, talking with Jesus, laying in his lap, and even being like a small child. I imagine there will be maybe the first million years, well, I'll be doing that with Jesus. Just thank you for loving me enough to send your son to die for me. Thank you for giving me an opportunity to believe in you. Maybe it's just a thank you time. Maybe it's just Jesus saying, it's okay. I love you, my son. That's a pretty good first million years. Then you get into, it never ends, and then my brain really starts to hurt. But I imagine as I read this passage, I start to dive into the power that is on full display. It's hard for me to comprehend that Jesus, God the Father, Jesus the Son, and the Holy Spirit are three in one, are united, they are together, and Jesus, as a part of the triune God, was there in the beginning, and he created all things. He knows all things. He is all powerful. He didn't lose his power, but he became a man so that he could rescue us. That's really hard to comprehend. But then Jesus was able to defeat sin and death. We can't defeat death on our own. When we're dead, unless somebody revives us, or finds a transplant of something to put into us to give us life again, but eventually you die. You cannot keep going. You will stop breathing. You will stop moving. But God, through his power, was able to allow Jesus to come back to life in and of himself, and he has ultimate power. And as we start to fathom that, then we recognize that this same power, as we see in verses 19 and 20, that raised Christ from the dead and seated him at the right hand of God, we see in verse 19, this same power is available to us. Wow! How? The power of God that was given to Jesus, that had the power to defeat sin and death, is available to us? That should make you worship. That should make you be astonished. And I have to ask, how? How am I supposed to use that power? Well, it's not for our benefit. We don't just inherit like superpowers. We're not like Superman to be some little mini God. We receive power from God so that we can tell the whole world, so that we can show the whole world how awesome and magnificent and wonderful God is. And we want everyone to be invited to join Jesus. We want everyone to be welcomed into the kingdom of God. We want everyone to make those decisions. That power is through us that we would not have without God giving it to us, is now available to the whole world. Christianity is not an individualistic religion. If you think that's what it is, you are mistaken. It is the most genuine, loving, welcoming belief system in the one true God. There are no races in God's eyes. We are all a masterpiece in God's eyes. We are all wanted in God's eyes. We are all designed in God's eyes. We are unique. We are wonderful in God's eyes. So when we look around, we are better together. We are on the full display of God's power and authority is on display through us who believe. That is beautiful. And so when we look at this, our goal is to grow the kingdom of God. The second element is to remember that his love, or Jesus' love, is everlasting. And we'll look at verse 21. It is far above any ruler or authority or power or leader or anything else, not only in this world, but also in the world to come. Since Christ created all things, in fact, He was a part of the creation, as I described earlier. He is in charge of all things in this world, over all authorities and all governments. Can we just praise God for that? These authorities are not in and of themselves authoritative. God gave them that authority. People, even though they think they earned the kingdom, or we have a new king of England, you know, all these things that we think are our rights, our privilege, our things. If God didn't want you to be in leadership, if God didn't want you to be the president, if God didn't want these things to happen, it wouldn't happen. He is in charge of all things. So we have to take the perspective of Jesus. If we don't even look at governments, don't even look at mankind for a little bit, we need to recognize that Jesus is far above, so much further above all leaders and dominions and powers, that he in fact created them. No one can surpass his greatness. He alone stands as the one true God, the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning, the end. There, verse 21 reminds us that no name given, nor any attempt at one, a name, in the future would be able to capture and define the greatness of God. So I want us to do this just for a little bit here. I want us to say aloud names of God. Maybe when you pray to God, you refer to God by this name. But could we just fill this room with names of God? And it's okay if people say them at the same time. But what are some names of God? More. I want to hear more.
Counselor.
Amazing.
Creator. Prince of Peace. Provider. Lord. Sustainer.
These could keep going, and they should keep going, because these are the names of God. Part of your assignment this week is just to reflect on the names of God and knowing that he is far greater than any name we could give him, but yet he's relational and intimate enough to be just the one name, Jesus. God. Holy Spirit. And he knows you by your name. Isn't that fascinating? And you could keep going, and you should, and I should. But for now, we're at a comma, and we're going to go to the third element. So the third element that we're going to focus on here right now, as followers of Christ Jesus, the same love and authority is available to us. Now, if you want to take a snapshot of those, we're not going to focus on all those cross-references, but they are all beautiful and they are wonderful. Just for time's sake, I'm just going to leave them up there for a little bit as I talk about verses 22 and also 19. Christ is the head of the church. And there's a quote from William Barclay that points this picture out a little bit clearer. It says, Christ needs the church, and the church needs Christ, like John 20, verse 21 says. But the head cannot function without the body, nor can the body function without the head. The head dreams and plans, but a head, a mind by itself, is of no use. A head must have a body to carry out the dream and plan. The message of peace in the power of Christ must be taken to men by the church, the body of Christ. Now, God doesn't need us, and he is the head. But he chose to use us, the body of Christ, for the betterment of this world, that we might know Christ. We have an opportunity to share the love of Christ with others through our actions and our words and our proclamation of Scripture and our genuine love and worship of God. Those simple acts have an opportunity to lead people towards God. But we recognize that we fall under the authority and dominion and power of Jesus. He is the head of the church. And as the head of the church, he leads us, the body. If you need direction, don't go to a pastor or a leader or someone over a church. You go straight to the Father. One thing I love about the New Testament church, you don't have to go through the priesthood anymore. You don't have to offer sacrifices. You don't have to make amends for all of your sins. You don't have to go with a blood sacrifice every day or every month or every year. You don't have to do those things anymore. Jesus came once and for all. The curtain was torn. We have access to the throne room. We can go right to Jesus, the head of the church, and we can get right with God. You and I, you don't need a pastor to pray you in. You don't need anybody to do it. You get an opportunity to be welcomed into a relationship with God. The head of the church wants a relationship with you. The God of this universe that we cannot even fathom his name wants a relationship with you. When Moses tried to say, God, what is your name? He said, I am who I am. That's a hard one to fathom as well. That means before all things, I am. Today, I am. Forevermore, I am. God is awesome, and he wants to know you. So I want to reflect on those three things before I give us our application this morning. Jesus has more power and authority than we can fathom. His love is everlasting. You might have to go back on that slide. I'm sorry, it was probably the third slide. As followers of Christ and Christians, that the same love and authority is available to us. And that's beautiful. So here's a couple of ideas. And whenever I give you ideas, my goal is not for you to feel like I gave you a huge assignment and you can't possibly do it all. But if there's something that stands out to you that God is prompting you to do, or you think, you know what, I do need to grow in my walk with Jesus. I need to go on this discipleship journey. I need to get closer to God. I want to get closer to God. Here's some ideas. So take them or leave them. They are an opportunity for you to grow. Your assignments for this week. List the names of God. That's not huge, right? Create a list of the ways you plan to worship God this week. Maybe you're administrative and you love to make lists. Great. Make a list of all the ways you want to worship God. Or make a list of all of what God is in charge of. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine God's to-do list for the week? That's a lot of post-it notes, I'll tell you that much. I can't even hardly keep myself up in the air, but he's got this blue ball that we live on, and it's spinning on its axis at a certain angle, and we're floating around a sun. I mean, come on. I can't even hardly stand when I think about that. And the fact that we're all just not flying around the room right now, that's pretty hard to imagine. And then we're like a grain of sand in the bigger scheme of the universe. It doesn't even make sense. And that's all on God's to-do list. And he does it with a thought. So maybe your list got a little bigger. Ask yourself, in what ways am I to trust God and use the gifts God has put within me to magnify his great name? Now, this isn't individualistic. You're not trying to make yourself look better. This is, what has God given me? What are gifts that he's given me, words that he's given me, talents that he's given me, so that I might magnify his great name. That changes the perspective. It's no longer about how can I look better? How can I look real good? How can people like me more? No, that's not even on the list. God, thank you for this gift and this talent that you've given me. Would you help me to use it to glorify you? We are all uniquely made. We are all a masterpiece. And when you look in the mirror, maybe you don't see it, but God does. I think it's time that we stop looking in the mirror at the surface level and we say, God, there was a moment in history when you created me. Would you give me permission to worship you with my life as a thanks for all that you have done. Without God's intervention, you and I don't exist. But he chose to make you and me. My hope is that we will lean into that and say, God, use me. Make your name greater because of me. Don't let people see me. Let them see you, Jesus, every single day. That's the greatest worship service of all, that more people would be drawn into the kingdom. I want to close this in prayer, but I'm wondering, Haley, if I feel like I cut off a song too soon. The last one I think we did before the offertory. If we could do a bit of that. I want to pray while she's getting prepared. I just think we need to lean into this time with the worship as well. So let me pray, and after the song we will be done for this morning, and you can go to Sunday school or get a donut or just stay in here and say the names of God, whatever you need to do. Let's pray though. Jesus, we magnify your great name. You are worthy of our praise. We are in awe of you. And some days we don't feel it, Lord. Sometimes we don't see it. Sometimes we miss it. But you keep showing up, God. You are always there. The amount of miracles that it takes for us to even get here on a Sunday morning or to get to work tomorrow morning, you're in charge of so much, and you have your angels on overtime. Lord, would we lean into you and say, we are thankful? Use us, Lord. We are grateful. We love you, God, for your name is great, and it is worthy of our praise. And you've given us this simple language that we seek to worship you with. I pray that every heart is at peace when they worship you. And as we close with song today, Lord, may this go as our marching orders, as our encouraging words, a song on our lips, a song on our mind all week long. We love you, Jesus. It's in your name we pray. Amen.